Hi, this is Dianne, and I want to talk about my most recent workshop that I attended. I had mentioned in another video that I would be attending workshops. This last workshop I attended was perhaps the most interesting one yet. This workshop was all about learning styles. I'm not going to talk about everything that was discussed at this workshop, as it was a lot of information. I will share some highlights though. Learning styles just means taking information to your brain and processing it to learn. I firmly believe that learning styles are something a person is born with. Before I talk about what my learning styles are, I will mention the three main learning styles. They are auditory, visual, and kinesthetic. Kinesthetic means hands-on learning. Also, I must mention that a person can have more than one learning style. I will describe the three main learning styles now. Auditory, of course, means hearing. Someone who learns with this style can learn material just by listening to someone speaking without the aid of visuals or hands-on activities. These learners do well at listening to lectures. Visual means these people learn best by having pictures in front of them to aid them in processing the information. They tend to create pictures in their minds. Some visual learners may highlight one item in one color and another item in a different color. Kinesthetic learners learn by using objects to help them learn material. You may be interested to learn that kinesthetic and visual learners tend to doodle. This doodling can actually help them figure things out. Some kinesthetic learners may play with objects, such as a stress ball, and they may use their finger when reading to help them follow along. Now I will talk about my learning styles and apply them to how I learn. I would say that I am a visual learner in some things and a kinesthetic learner when learning other things. I don't do very well sitting through a lecture. I need visuals and hands-on activities. I'm very visual if someone mentions an object. For example, if a person says flag, I'll create or see a flag in my mind. I also like pictures to help me follow along. It's far easier for me to have the pictures explaining something rather than just the text. Don't get me wrong, I need the text, but the pictures with text helps me understand the material better. Visual learners sometimes daydream, and yes, I will admit that I sometimes do. This does not mean that I am not paying attention. Next time you see a visual or a kinesthetic learner doodling, remember, he or she may be using doodling as a medium to help them learn. I will confess that even though I learn some things visually, I'm not that great at putting jigsaw puzzles together, even with a picture on the box. Whenever I run into a snag with visual learning, kinesthetic learning sometimes helps. As I mentioned earlier, kinesthetic learners learn by actually doing a hands-on activity. Pictures are useful for me with this style of learning, but actually doing the activity can sometimes aid me more. For example, learning the computer. I remember taking computer courses from the local adult education center. A textbook with pictures was provided. First, I read over the text and looked at the pictures. Next, I actually used the computer and did the activities over and over. This is what finally made some of it stick. I mentioned doodling earlier. Well, I'll confess that I am a doodler, even though I cannot draw at all. However, if I can read and understand my own doodles, perhaps I can come to a solution. Instead of a stress ball, I may play with my necklace, a pen, or other object. The texture of stress balls kind of bothers me. There have been times that I'll use my finger to help me follow along with reading, like I'm doing right now. Unfortunately, when I was in school, we were discouraged from using our finger to follow along in later grades. I disagree with that. If that helps a person, so be it. I'll use my finger if the font is rather small, or if it's a rather long paragraph that I have to read, such as this. The font in this book that I'm reading from is a larger font, so sometimes I can read it better and not necessarily have to use my finger to follow along. Although there are times in which I do read these scripts, as you can see, using my finger. In addition, I like to read these talks over a few times before I actually start videoing them. I obviously can't use my finger to help me follow along with my music when I'm singing and playing piano, so there have been times when I've gotten lost in a piece of music. This is why I like to practice my music well before singing and playing in front of people. I try to memorize a good amount of the lyrics. Also, you may or may not be surprised to know this, but I do best if there's white space between paragraphs. These are some examples of how kinesthetic and visual learning styles apply to my life. Now I want to talk about some important environmental factors when it comes to learning. Bear in mind that what I'm going to say here applies for me. Someone else may prefer different environmental factors, and that's okay. I'll talk about sound first. For me, I prefer to have some quiet, non-lyrical music playing while I'm trying to learn something. I remember while I was in high school, I would study with music playing in the background. Believe it or not, the music would help my brain to absorb some of the material I was to study. I must emphasize, though, that I do not like loud music when I'm trying to study. Lighting. Fluorescent lighting bothers me if the lights make a humming noise. It's not the lighting itself, it's the noise. Sometimes it's better just to turn fluorescent lights off and turn on a regular light. I like a light that's bright enough for me to see, but is not too bright. Incandescent lighting works best for me. Temperature. I don't know anybody who likes to try and learn in a very cold or a very hot room. I like it cool, but not cold. Design. Some people are comfortable sitting on hard wooden or hard plastic chairs while learning, and that's okay if you're comfortable with that. However, I myself prefer a chair with a cushion on the seat to sit on. In addition to design, I prefer an environment where people aren't going to mind if I move my foot around, get up and walk, or stretch, etc. I don't know if this really fits into environment category, but for me, the time of day is important. As I mentioned in another video, I do best at night. This has always been the case for me. Nighttime is when I feel more alert. In addition, nighttime feels more peaceful and quiet for me, and that's easier for my sensory issues. I find the daytime to be very busy and stimulating. It often is very difficult for people to understand how and why I keep my, quote, wacky hours. I'm going to now talk about the sociological part of learning. Some people prefer to learn in groups, others in pairs, some alone, some on a team, and more. For myself, I probably do better in a one-on-one situation and then alone. However, if I'm learning something in, let's say, an informative workshop and don't have to worry about writing an exam, a group is okay. Taking notes has always proved difficult for me, as it's hard to distinguish the most important parts of a subject. On-the-job training would definitely be best presented as one-on-one for myself. I don't know about you, but I find that if I know I'm going to be sitting in a longer learning session, doing a small workout or some kind of movement beforehand helps. I think getting oxygen to the brain before learning is healthy anyway. There are three more learning styles I learned at this workshop in addition to the main three. These ones are analytical. A person using this skill will take steps and break them apart. Global. Someone who can take in all information and put it into order at a later time. And impulsive. An impulsive learner doesn't need much time to learn something. Well, this shouldn't come as any shock to any of you who have been following my videos, but I would definitely say I fit best in the analytical category. I have to be able to take steps and break them apart. Even when I'm first learning to play a new song on the piano, I often will learn just the right hand first. When I learn that, then I try the left hand playing solid chords. Lastly, if the song can be played with broken chords, then I try to play the broken chords. Similarly, I like instructions given in a clear, step-by-step manner. Would you like to learn some interesting facts? Well, on the learning pyramid in the passive teaching methods, you may be interested to learn that only 5% is learned from lectures alone. This makes a great deal of sense to me. 10% is learned by reading, 20% learned by audio-visual, 30% demonstration. I found this to be quite amazing. Participatory teaching methods are much higher. 50% is learned in group discussions. However, for me, this doesn't necessarily agree. 75% is learned by practice. Practice is how I learn a great deal. Examples pertaining to myself are learning to play piano by practicing my music, and learning to use the computer by practicing hands-on activities. And last but not least, would you believe me if I told you that on that same pyramid, 90% was learned by teaching others? Very interesting. I hope this talk that I have given will give you at least a bit of an idea of how many people learn, and that what works for one person may not necessarily work for another. As I had said earlier, there was an awful lot of ground to cover in that workshop, but these are some main highlights I wanted to share. It is my hope that maybe educators seeing this video will now have a better idea of how learning styles vary from one student to another when teaching their classes. Thank you for watching this video. I will now conclude with my usual slogan, good luck with your journeys.